Hello and welcome to this 59th edition of Office Hours presented by Something Digital. For now, this is actually a little bit of a question mark. You know, have we been doing the winging it segment? We're winging it right now. We have two people right now. You heard the other one, myself, Tony Trelli, the host of this here program, and Brian J. Lang.
Hello. I believe
that Phillip Jackson is going to join us, but who knows? We're winging it. Here we are. But on the show today, here's what we're talking about. It is June 25th today, which means that we are exactly 6 months from Christmas. Exactly 6 months. Does that feel weird? Does that feel weird? It feels like it was just New Year's.
This is the weirdest year ever. I think I've said this before, but it is going fast and slow, like the fastest and the slowest that I can possibly imagine at the exact same time.
It doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't. This year doesn't make sense. This 2020 is the year of confusion, and it does not make sense.
I totally agree. I don't know what's going on here. But either way, we will be talking about holiday because now is the time. In fact, everybody should be preparing earlier than this, but now's the time to really make it happen. We will also talk a little bit about social media and which platforms our panelists think are leading the charge as far as commerce. And then Phillip posted something interesting on Twitter the other day. And he made the claim that the primary benefit of working in the e-com agency space is being in the know about corporate retail strategy 12 to 18 months before it actually happens. Speaking of the man, the myth, the legend, Phillip Jackson has joined us. He's graced us with his presence.
Hey there, Tony. And thanks for having me on Office Hours. I'm going to give you a big one of these. What my kids do now. That's how old they are. It's great.
That's hilarious. and you know, I haven't decided yet. We're gonna have to figure this out at some point in this episode. We're 5 days away from Magento One end of life. Are we done talking about it? We might be done talking about it.
Yep.
Phillip's putting his foot down. Brian, you're the deciding vote. Are we talking about it or are we not talking about it?
We're not talking about it today. That doesn't mean we won't talk about it in the future because there's plenty of merchants that are still on Magento 1, and so they're going to need some help.
maybe we'll table this for our next edition of Office Hours.
I like that.
We talk about, hey, Magento 1 end of life has happened. Now what? So let's stop talking about future episodes. Let's talk about this episode. Let's start with social media. Brian J. Lang, one of our clients came to us and asked us this question, actually. Which social media platform do you believe is leading the charge in commerce?
I think it's a big question of who you are, what you do. There are a lot of different ways to leverage social media. And so I think it'd be really silly of me to say that like one is better than the other. It really, really depends on what you're selling and how you're selling it. Obviously, the whole Facebook empire, which includes Instagram, is a big win. It's just no reason not to be leveraging Instagram at this point. But there are some really interesting things going on with TikTok, as you know, Carly is clearly, which is the psychographic.
What is Carly? Brian?
What is Carly? Carly stands for can't afford real life
I
yet. So yes, we can talk a little more about who Carly is, but Gen Z is definitely out there on TikTok, and there's lots of reasons to like what TikTok is doing with commerce. ByteDance is owned by GGV. GGV has a very clear understanding of brands and commerce and has made some of the smartest investments in the world in brands. And so I think that TikTok has got a clear understanding of like how to go to market with commerce and has got some great content out there about how to do that. But there's still some other things that are interesting going on. Pinterest has been investing heavily in commerce features, led by Jeremy King, who's the former CTO at Walmart. Ever since he came on board, I think about a year ago, they've made some heavy investment in commerce, commerce-focused features. And I think that if you're the right kind of brand, and there are not every brand should necessarily be leveraging Pinterest, but I think there's a lot of opportunity for a lot of different types of brands to leverage Pinterest. If you want to connect people or help them accomplish things, or have, you know, stuff that's like aspirational projects or to-dos, or workshop type stuff, or grand millennial type stuff, Pinterest is really, really compelling right now. And the conversion rate I've heard on Pinterest is actually really, 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 really good. People that are on there are looking to actually accomplish things, whereas people spend a lot of time browsing Instagram and just looking at things.
For those who are not in the know, so you mentioned TikTok has some commerce capabilities. And you also mentioned that a company owns TikTok. Am I right?
ByteDance, yeah.
Okay. Can you dig
It's not that they don't own them. They are them, effectively.
They are them. Okay. Can you dig into who that is, number one? And can you dig in at all to TikTok's capabilities around commerce?
Well, ByteDance is basically TikTok. So
Are you saying ByteDance?
ByteDance. Sorry.
Word. Again, this is for those who aren't in the know. I had never heard of ByteDance.
Yep. They're sort of the parent company of TikTok, but they effectively are TikTok. Like that's what you know them for. So there's not really much to dive into as far as like, oh wow, they do all this other really cool stuff. They're TikTok. What was the other thing you wanted to know more about, Tony?
Yeah. So you mentioned grand millennials. I consider myself one of those grand millennials, and therefore this whole TikTok thing, the kids are on it now, you know?
Right. You're more
they need
like
to get off my lawn and keep using TikTok, basically, is what I'm trying to say.
You would do a little better on Pinterest. TikTok is much more ephemeral. It's really fun stuff that'll last for a period of time and bring a lot of meaning and value to the moment. And it's also a place for people to try things and invent things and have fun and do it with friends. And so I'm Phillip's got a ton of additional thoughts on TikTok. I'll let him take over here.
Yeah. Not to tell you you're wrong, Brian, but TikTok does not have commerce. TikTok has piloted commerce with Levi's and a couple other brands. And the press release that came out of that was it doubled page views, which means it sent a ton of unqualified traffic and didn't convert. Because if they had converted a ton of customers, the story would be, we rose sales by 35% via TikTok.
True. You're right about that. But brands are running campaigns on TikTok right now. I know that.
I think brands are socially engaging on TikTok. I think that's different. That's branded engagement. The things that actually drive the things that drive conversion, which is what I think we're talking about, is not just like branded engagement in a platform to say, like, it's not a sell proposition so much as it is a like engage and inspire and, you know, and
that's inform. A really fair point. Yeah, totally agree.
So, you know, brands can and probably should be thinking about their social strategy in every, you know, in every meaningful social platform. But to actually engage in commerce, I think, Brian, you have an astute point in that there are places where people are more likely to buy. It turns out that Instagram is an incredible driver of intent to purchase. And for many years, Facebook was content for people to get that intent stoked and then hop out over to Amazon and find the suitable product. I don't think that that's what the future will hold. I think Facebook is partnering and in commerce in a lot of different ways to actually like bring the commerce experience and the checkout experience to more retailers in app native without leaving. Right now, if you are a business on TikTok, you can create a product feed and pricing feed and tag products to jump out to your e-commerce platform, no matter how big or small your following is. But you have to be only in the like upper echelon of brands that actually are running, that have massive social followings before they'll open up the commerce component to like check out on Instagram without ever leaving the confines of the platform. So if anybody's doing commerce on social right now, like what social commerce is, it's Instagram. But I want to flip the script a little bit, Tony, because that social commerce is an interesting proposition. I think it is interesting. But I think there's something that is not being talked about or hasn't really been talked about as heavily, which is Walmart in the past 3 weeks has partnered with Shopify, Postmates, and with ThredUp. And Postmates, like what that partnership ecosystem that Walmart is building there, and the access that they are creating for every other type of interaction that is a purchase intent interaction through ThredUp and through Shopify sounds like a much bigger market opportunity than the Instagram commerce model is, and possibly quicker to market than it would be to get hundreds of thousands of mom and pop retailers to adopt Instagram as a social selling platform. So I think that there's a bunch of things happening here, but the thing that I find to be interesting is probably the Walmart conversation today, which is not on topic for what you originally started out with, but probably the thing that I think will move the needle greatest in the shortest period of time.
Can you tell me more about that partnership and what it means? Because I think that what a lot of people are going to hear is that Shopify and ThredUp and Walmart have a partnership.
Shopping, if you go to Google and you type into Google search, Led Zeppelin t-shirt, right? Just give you a use case. It could be that once upon a time, a ThredUp ad might have shown up in Google shopping results, or it could have been an organic search result for ThredUp, and it would hop you out to the ThredUp app or into their e-commerce store for you to go buy it secondhand from someone else where it's already there ready to ship. Now, not only will you get those same experiences, but Walmart is partnering with ThredUp to expose the entirety of the ThredUp catalog into Walmart's e-commerce. So if you're already prone to shopping at Walmart, you might be even more prone to shop at Walmart now because they have the thing you were looking for, and ThredUp has greater exposure to a greater number of people. Not just to mention something to the tune of, I think Walmart did, I forget what it was, a little over 7 billion in e-commerce. All of that online interaction now is exposed to a world of secondhand goods through ThredUp and their partnership, which I think is really interesting.
Well,
and
it's really go ahead. From a natural, there's a very natural fit there. The types of products that ThredUp receives as opposed to some of the other like secondhand markets, like Poshmark or The RealReal, which are much more luxury oriented. ThredUp, I think, is a lot more broad market. And so it really hits on the target market that Walmart is looking to address. Sorry to cut you off, keep going.
No, I think you're right. I think also that's why Shopify makes so much sense. Shopify, sorry, I have some work going on upstairs. Shopify makes a ton of sense because partnering with Shopify for, you know, its million e-commerce sites that exist on the internet, most of those are in the small to medium-sized business range and provide affordable products to a wide variety of customers. And I think exposing, you know, having the ability to be published in a marketplace like Walmart from within the Shopify app ecosystem with two or three clicks is another like example of a killer app. Like if you are a small to medium-sized merchant, you were probably already thinking, how do I get on Amazon or Walmart as a marketplace to begin with? And this shortened that path significantly. And I think it's worth talking about.
It's interesting. They are only piloting with 1,200 merchants, by the way. So don't expect Walmart to get just like flooded immediately with like hundreds of thousands, if not millions more products, which is probably a good thing. The Walmart marketplace is, you know, it's pretty hefty already. It's not, doesn't touch Amazon's obviously, but I think what's also really interesting about this is that Magento tried to do the similar thing with Amazon a couple of years ago, and they did, and they introduced this sort of shopping channel push. I think what's significant about this is that the Walmart channel has been something that retailers just haven't, I think, leveraged as much as they could yet. And so there's like this huge opportunity where as the Walmart app starts to pick up more and more popularity, and I believe it is growing like month over month in terms of users, to sort of get a jump on winning the top spots. Whereas Amazon's so saturated, like it's really, really, really hard. It's very competitive to jump in and like get in on Amazon right now. I think that this Walmart partnership offers merchants that adopt early lots of opportunity to go and get out in front of people first and to secure that sort of authority in that marketplace. So now is the time to do it. If you can, the sooner you can get on board with this, the better it's going to be for you in the long run. Speaking of the Walmart app, I think I've harped on this a little bit already, but I tried it again for the first time in a long time, just recently in the past few months. I was blown away with the Walmart app. I think the Walmart app is incredible. I think that they've done a really good job of creating a UI that is super intuitive. When you're shopping their online store versus your local store is really clear. Going to the different departments is super clear. It's got a really great look. It's such an update from like where they've been in the past. The Walmart app is the kind of app that I want to shop on. So
Ryan is a Walmart stan. I never knew it.
I haven't been. I can't believe what I'm saying. Like, this is incredible. Their app is really, really good.
We can hear it in your voice how excited you are about it.
Like, yeah, like you're shouting, you're so excited. I'm going to have to go freaking download it now.
Yeah, do it. Try it.
It's amazing.
So before we move on to the next segment, I mean, what I'm hearing is that, to use one of Brian Lang's favorite phrases, what I'm hearing is that the benefit for this on the Walmart side is because having ThredUp and the brands that are available on Shopify, it gives them more stickiness in the market for people to keep coming back to Walmart as a marketplace and as an app. And on the ThredUp and the Shopify merchant side, it gives them exposure to significantly more people.
I think that both of those things are true. I would say it a little differently. It increases top of funnel for them because it makes Walmart Walmart has a greater opportunity to capture customers that otherwise wouldn't shop there. Now, right? Like if you're going to make it's the marketplace model. Like, and while I'm here, I can buy X, Y, and Z. It's like you can consolidate a bunch of purchases and have one hand to shake in that relationship. I think that is a powerful driver for new opportunity, like new traffic to the Walmart platform. Also, if those purchases in theory were going to happen anyway on ThredUp or happen anyway on Shopify, Walmart now gets a cut of that pie and both parties can win. And I think that that's a brilliant execution of a strategy of everybody, all eyes are on Amazon. Everybody's trying to take Amazon down. Even Amazon knows that Amazon can't dominate in the way that it has forever. And in fact, so much so that they have invested billions and billions in their music and their original programming to diversify the offer and make it more attractive and make that sticky. Because the retail component is going to, the road is rising to meet the consumer expectation at the e-commerce level for everybody. Logistics, last mile, technology, the e-commerce platform, everything's becoming better as a whole, and we'll have to, because we're all going to be socially distant for a very long time and shopping from our homes. And all right, so we could keep on and on and on and on, but yes.
I will, because you brought up a really interesting point, and I just read an article about this. I apologize, I don't remember where it was. It might have been in Medium, but they were talking about how, you know, obviously the purpose of a marketplace is to grow revenue, but really, if you're going to grow a successful marketplace, it has to be about happiness for everyone. And if the customer is happier by being able to get everything in one place, and the brands in the marketplace are happier because they get more exposure, and the marketplace is happier because ultimately you grow the marketplace, then you have a successful marketplace at the end of the day. Like, it has to be a focus on making everybody happy more and growing revenue less, because the more you make people happy, the more your revenue is going to be in a marketplace type setting. I will post that article on Facebook when I find it later. And I'll make sure that I'm able to cite that source, because it's not fair to just say things and then not talk about who's actually saying it.
And Tony, you're jumping ahead a little bit as well, because I think the next topic was going to be holiday, but one of the things that Phillip talked about in his homepage article on retail touchpoints was the fact that marketplaces are going to be a really important way, or they could be a good strategy for in making sure that you, one, capitalize on opportunity that is available in the market at this very moment. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. And two, make sure that you, when we come into this dry holiday season that we're going to see, have different ways for customers to be able to take advantage of your brand more, like your experience, and not have to go elsewhere. So that it's about making sure that people are going to spend money coming up. The question is, where is that money going to go? And if you have more ways for people to spend money on your market, on your experience, AKA, I think this is like just incredible foresight by Walmart to make these moves, then you're going to keep gaining that sort of share of wallet. And sometimes gaining share of wallet for like minimal profit is worth it to retain your customer's eyes and focus, so that the things you do make margin on, you can maintain that purchase, those purchases. So not to take my head too far.
That is a perfect transition to talking about holiday. And the first thing that I want to talk about is, Phillip, you've said on a number of occasions now that holiday, quote unquote, the holiday season, the holiday shopping season needs to come early in 2020. So talk a little bit about that and talk about why. And I think it relates really well to what Brian was saying.
I could talk about this for 3 hours. For the length of the runtime of Christopher Nolan's Tenet, the new movie coming out, where people will risk their lives to go out to watch a movie in the movie theater, I could sit and talk about holiday 2020, but I will spare you. The thing that I think everybody can recognize is that holiday has been coming earlier anyway. Over the last 5 or 6 years, for all kinds of reasons, holiday has crept up out of Black Friday, right? Cyber Monday bled back into Black Friday, and then it was Black Friday week, and then we had all of November has become deals week. And I think that part of that, like if I had to hazard a guess as to why that has happened, is not because greedy capitalism, it's probably maybe part of it, or even consumerism. But I think that we've had like this natural problem in pre-cloud computing era that we couldn't serve all of the demand all at one time. And that demand, once we squandered the opportunity and they all came on our website on the one day, they went and found something else somewhere else, and the opportunity to close the sale was gone. And so we started over time sort of making it a longer event to sort of spread out and even out that curve, flatten that curve, if you will, where we had one dramatic spike.
Don't
too soon. Fine. Okay.
Yeah.
One dramatic spike of an event on one day that we were not prepared for. Right. And that would effectively, like, we couldn't serve all the opportunity that was available. And that's why I think it's crept back into all of November over many, many years. I think that there will be another important market for us right now, which is that holiday, well, we're going to have to get people to spend money sooner so that we get anything from them whatsoever. If they're ready to spend money in October or November for holiday 2020, you want to be there ready to purchase. I think we're going to start seeing, just like as you, at the end of August, Costco will have Christmas trees out and wrapping paper. And I believe that e-commerce will start to see the same sort of thing happen in the e-commerce retail. We're not going to wait till end of October, beginning of November to start seeing holiday gift guides. Those suckers are coming in late August. And we're, because right now, economically, there's some certainty in the next couple of weeks that things might be okay. I think some people are getting back to work. Some states are opening back up. But we also have, like, is there another economic stimulus coming? We don't know. There's all kinds of uncertainty as to whether, like, the next few months are financially stable for some Americans. 5 months from now, we could be deep into a second wave. Who knows? Like, there's so much uncertainty about what will happen at the end of the year that retailers, as a hedge, will start to bring holiday into Q3. And I think, like, that just sounds natural. I don't think I have to prove that to you. But one of the ways that you can do that effectively, and I said this in the Retail Touchpoints article, is start to offer other things other than your core products and your core category. I think Todd Snyder does this in a beautiful way, but other brands have started to do it as well. And I believe I will also have to source this afterwards. I think it's Outdoor Voices. Somebody has begun to sell skincare on their website. I think it's, especially during summer, is a very natural, and especially if you're an active wear brand, it's a very natural tie-in to the kinds of things that someone might buy while they're shopping with you on the site. We'll see a lot more of that, and that'll give people a lot more reason to buy something for you and buy something for them. And we'll have to find ways. I've said this one other time on another live stream, but I'll say it again. People are not going to stop spending money in 2020. They stopped going out of their homes the last 3 months, but people will still spend money. In fact, even during economic downturns, people spend money on things. There's a PlayStation 5 coming out this year. There's an Xbox One Series X that's coming out this year. People will buy video games and they'll spend thousands of dollars on accessories and games and peripherals. They will buy a new TV at the same time, even if it means doing, like, incurring some debt to do so. They will spend money on things that they think are worth it and worth their time. The question is, are you as a retailer there and ready when they're ready to spend their money? That's what we all have to kind of get our minds around.
Yeah, I mean, the whole Carly psychographic that we brought up earlier, it's just, you know, when there's an economic downturn, there's just more Carlys out there, right? Yep. That's, I feel like that's kind of what you're saying a little bit. And at the same time, this holiday coming in early and being so, like, we're 6 months away from Christmas, we're 5 months away from holiday. What is the, like, it's almost like take advantage now, because you don't even know if you'll be, you don't know if you're going to be able to take advantage in 5 months. So you kind of have to take advantage now. Brian?
Yeah, I would agree. I think also consumers are recognizing that sort of the nature or the position that retailers are in right now, and the level of discounting that we've seen in the past few months has been just off the charts. We've saw like Black Friday like discounts in the spring. And we got a bunch of money. This is a weird, weird, weird economic situation that we're in, because actually personal income rose a little bit while jobless rates plummeted, you know, we're in the weirdest position where unemployment is going up, but we have more money to spend and everything went on sale.
Yeah, it's a bifurcated consumer, I think, too. Like, yeah, there are some people who are, yeah, this is some people extremely disadvantaged through this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Even those that went on unemployment, though, saw significant additional unemployment,
right,
because of the stimulus package. And so that's all going to end, to your point, Phillip. I think that consumers are getting used to deeper and deeper discounts. And so looking ahead at Black Friday, if you feel like you've already given up margin to keep selling, right now, and you're looking ahead at Black Friday and you're like, well, am I going to be able to discount and like stay in business because I won't be making any money on the stuff that I sell, or I'm going to be running at a loss. You're not looking to acquire customers. You're just trying to make sales. I think we're going to be in a tough spot. So I think the best thing that we can do, or one of the more important things we can do, is kind of keep our heads a little bit. And that is to remember that, you know, if you have the ability to remain focused on serving your customers well and providing them with like deeper levels of service, instead of using discounts, give them personal touches or go the extra mile, find other ways to personalize and connect yourself to customer. And there's, I feel like this is worth an article unto itself. Then do that, because I think that we can't just keep up discounting. It's not gonna pan out in the end.
I have a lot of thoughts about that, but I like nothing is organized in my brain right now to actually respond to that. I agree with you. At the same time, like I have this thought in my brain of like, you know, there's so much uncertainty out there, like Phillip said, that you can do everything right to serve your customer, but it's still like there. I don't know. It's tough. I don't even know. I don't even know where my thought process is going.
Yeah, no, and I agree. Like live to fight another day for sure. Yeah. Like if you're in the position where you are going to literally go bankrupt, I get it. Like you've got to do what you've got to do to just try and survive and like get on to the next wave of things and try to rebuild from there. But if you have any ability and you know to get above that, then do it. Now is the time. Yeah. Because your customers are going to remember it. They're going to remember you taking care of them through this period and responding to their needs. And that's going to last on into future years.
I guess what's even more confusing to me is the businesses that are actually doing well right now. Some of the health and beauty businesses, some of the, workout equipment businesses. How do you, like, it is June 25th and you've been doing well for 2 or 3 months now. How do you continue to ride this wave into Q3 and Q4? How much different does your business look like? Again, there's just so much uncertainty. It's an impossible question to answer. How do we continue to ride this wave?
You're right. I think you're right. Like, can fragrance and skincare continue to be dominant in e-commerce for the next 10 months when they really weren't before, prior to folks being at home? I think there are luxuries that people treat themselves to as part of like in a purchase cycle. Like in there's a rhythm of retail that people are in. People might have bought a new car this year. Probably not going to buy a new car. They don't really see the need to, or re-up on a lease, but they'll splurge on some, you know, $150, $200 cologne or $1,000 bed sheet set that they wouldn't have bought otherwise. They're going to splurge. It's where they splurge that is, I think, shifting around because of the nature of this particular economic environment. That's sort of a half thought. Can you draw a direct line to the kind of person that might have bought a BMW that now will buy, you know, Egyptian cotton sheets instead? I don't know.
It goes back to what Brian was saying. It's about understanding your customer. Like what is that big purchase going to be for each individual on this call? You know, if you are Carly and you still want to make that big purchase to ultimately bring yourself happiness, like it's not logical. It's purely emotional. It's purely, this is going to make me happy. And this is about 100% about that. Like, understand your customer and understand how to provide that happiness to your customer. And that's exactly what Brian was saying. I think that provides a lot of context.
And so, you know, practically, and actually, you know, I've got an article coming out to this end, like this means empowering your customer service teams to maybe like not run on a script. Like maybe
empower people.
Yeah, give them the ability to spend more time with customers and recommend things to them and help them through things, and turn your customer service centers into actually revenue centers. I think it's a huge opportunity right now, especially because, and this is interesting, I think we're going to see I should probably check out data here, but we probably have seen a spike in customer service calls in general, because a lot of people are used to just returning things in store. And sometimes getting a refund and making a return online is something that people are a little bit unfamiliar with, or maybe isn't as clear for your brand. Some brands have done a really good job with this, and it's really, really simple and clear. But a lot of brands, I think, there's still like maybe even a phone call involved in making a return. And so if there's no store to go return to, then you're going to get more phone calls, which is actually more opportunities to spend time with your customers, which will allow you to get to know them better and actually recommend other things for them to purchase.
My, by the way, I asked what everybody's purchase would be. My purchase is definitely a good bottle of wine. That's your splurge. If I am in the dumps and need to, make myself happy, buying a good bottle of wine, that's my thing. Okay. So we have about 10 minutes left and I want to get to this last topic. Phillip, you claimed on Twitter the primary benefit of being in the e-commerce agency space is being in the know about corporate retail strategy 12 to 18 months ahead of time. And in fact, a few people replied to this tweet and asked you to dig more into it. Let's do it.
You put the emphasis on the wrong syllable. I said the primary benefit.
The primary, you're right.
The primary benefit. the primary benefit. There's a lot of benefits, right, to being in this line of work. And I think it kind of gets poo-pooed a whole lot of, agency work is kind of this, sort of like a necessary evil in the world. Folks, seem to sort of hate their agencies, or they seem to demean folks that work at agencies. But all that criticism aside, there are some serious benefits to being in this space. One of the main ones being when you're in an e-commerce agency like we are, and especially if you're of the kind that will respond to an RFP, you have close platform partnerships like we do, you will find yourself from time to time seeing an RFP that is being circulated and being bid on from big, big corporations who are charting out a 24-month strategy. And those RFPs, a typical deal might take 4, 5, 6 plus months to even sign, right? Like, you're outlining a solution, you're bidding for the work, you're competing against multiple agencies, they're meeting with dozens of people. They're trying to figure out how much they're going to spend, when the costs are going to be incurred, what platforms they might select in the end. It's a very long decision process. And once they've decided on that, you get to work, it's another 6 to 10 months before the work completes and is delivered. And then from there, it's probably another month or two before, everything is settled down and ironed out before the press release goes out. And it's probably another 6 months before customers actually start to notice and jump on and start to feel the effects of, or realize the benefits of, all the investment that they made, whether it's an additional marketing strategy or greater customer insights or additional site functionality and features or a total refresh of the brand. It takes 2 years from the time you shop an RFP before you start to see the effects in the marketplace of having built and delivered the site. Anyone in the e-commerce agency space is a fortune teller. When you see an RFP shopped around, you know what's coming in 24 months, because everyone's building for the brand that they're going to have in 2 to 3 years, not for the one they're going to have today. So that's what I meant by that.
So obviously don't name any names here.
No.
But if you, can you give us an example of something you might have seen in the past 5 years or so that you saw come to fruition?
Yeah, so there was, I said it on Mage Talk, which is a Magento podcast that I have recently restarted. Like and subscribe. MageTalk.com, always be promoting. I said 3 years ago on Mage Talk.
Coffee is for promoters, by the way.
if you are an agency, you need to start learning about what it takes to build B2B e-commerce capabilities. I said that emphatically, that I had some understanding and information that there are big manufacturing companies who are going to take their businesses digital, and you need to be ready and prepared for it. And lo and behold, you know, it paved the way for 2 years of very strong business for a lot of e-commerce platforms that decided that they wanted to support the B2B segment. Everything from aerospace and engineering to tools and parts to school supplies, a lot of traditional B2B companies put their businesses online and invested in digital in the last two years, and we called it ahead of time. Why? How did we know that? Because we started entertaining all the requests for proposals 3 years ago, and yet here we are. And the things that a lot of folks are doing, at least in the e-commerce and direct-to-consumer space, are they're starting to like watch job boards. They look at Indeed, they looked at LinkedIn, and they see what positions are being hired. So when you see, this was a public tweet, you know, when you see a giant entertainment company that is a global entertainment company hiring a director of e-commerce and a strategist and business development expert in e-commerce, and when you see a gigantic CPG brand with a known coffee brand name hiring for the same roles, you can kind of start to say, they must be heading towards retail, they must be heading towards direct to consumer, and they must be making additional investment in their e-commerce. Anyway, I see a lot of emphatic nodding from Brian. I'll turn it over to him to make.
No, I was just agreeing with you wholeheartedly. Yeah. I think, yeah, we see this all the time. 24 months is probably even it's more than that. It's further than that, because oftentimes you're just talking about like the initial build cycle. Oftentimes they'll lay out 5-year roadmaps. There's a lot of like nice to have and next step stuff on there that you don't launch in the first phase that's there that you're going to iterate on over the period of a few years. And so you're 100% correct. Also that job board thing is something that I definitely look at all the time. And may or may not have sent you that global entertainment job.
You might have. But what I find is really interesting, Tony, and I'd love your perspective on it, is that there's this idea that responding to these kinds of RFPs is not worth the time and it's too much effort. And I know in particular, there's, you know, one of our e-commerce platform partners, like very, very publicly has said they don't do the RFP thing. So I'm curious what you think about, is that a dying practice, and is that like crystal ball for agencies going to go away at some point?
You know, it's so funny. It's so funny because I hear people talk about that all the time, that they hate filling out RFPs. They hate like requirements documents and all that stuff. It takes so much time. It's so much effort. To me, it's not the time and the effort that's the problem. It's the type of effort. It feels, when you're filling out an RFP or you're responding to an RFP, it feels like busy work, as opposed to perhaps a company coming to you and saying, hey, I have this project that I want to do. Can you help me scope it out? That is actually way more time and way more effort, but it is collaborative and it feels meaningful. As a worker, I am a very systematic worker, and that's like kind of my profile. I am the person who always understands the CRM, the one who fills out the things that you're supposed to fill out. That's why, you know, I think that some administrative people who deal with salespeople tend to like me a little bit more, because I actually fill out the things that I'm supposed to fill out, and no salespeople do that.
That is not at all a timely conversation. But yes, carry on.
So I feel that if a brand comes to you and has all of their ideas, all of their wild ideas laid out for you, I take that as a benefit. And I say, Look, wow, they've put in so much effort. If they've put in effort, that means that they actually want to do this thing, as opposed to coming to me and saying, hey, there's this project that I'm thinking about, help me scope it out. All of a sudden, it's like totally like that project can go anywhere. And any question I ask, I can be held to kind of that question of like, do you want this? And the response is always, well, that's an interesting idea. Maybe I do want that. As opposed to an RFP, which is very thought out. And I personally have, you know, am much happier when that's laid out for me. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah. I think it does. And so I don't think RFPs are going away because I don't think big corporations are going away. And I think the way that big corporations make decisions are sort of at a glacial pace with lots of stakeholders involved. And they could those things be done differently? Probably. Could they be done faster? Definitely. But what typically happens is the success we have found in our business at Something Digital, the most successful relationships that we have and the most successful e-commerce sites that we manage are the ones where the innovation is shared on both sides, where we're both working together to challenge each other in the relationship, both as the business and as the agency, to create something that's new and differential and exciting and appealing. It never works well when only one side of that equation is trying to execute some strategic vision. You have to be partnered together. I think it says a lot to have a company. Now, there's certainly bad examples of this. I have seen PDF farms. I have seen RFP farms that just take 7,000 line Excel documents and lock them down and say, like, everything is must have at launch. Yeah. And it's every feature that has ever existed in the history of ever in e-commerce. But for all of those, there's, you know, for every one of those I've seen, there's been 20 that are actually really thoughtful and reasonable and worth the time and the effort to put into it.
It's a conversation starter, it should be a conversation starter. And I think that's kind of what you're talking about, is there are RFPs out there that are not, and that's kind of the problem with those. I'm in agreement with you there. So that's all a really good point. And let's move on to this last portion. We are starting to, or me personally, I'm starting to invest a little more effort into office hours as an entity. And so you people who are listening will start to see more around show notes, more around quotes from office hours, and more around promotion of getting people to tune in live. So I'm really excited to show that to everyone and kind of see what that brings about. I'm excited for more participation. We had some really great participation from some of our clients in the last couple of weeks. So I'm excited. And I'm looking forward to that, and I hope you all are too. So that being said, our 60th edition of Office Hours presented by Something Digital will be on July 9th. We're all looking forward to that, and we already previewed a little bit of it earlier. So July, see you all on July 9th. Thank you, Phillip. Thank you, Brian. And thanks, everyone, for tuning in.
Thanks, Tony. See you.